So the vast majority of CIMTs that patients bring in to me are really bad. I think the absolute worst one was last week. A patient brought a CIMT where his local radiologist told him, "Yes, this is a CIMT." It wasn't even in the neck. It was a lower extremity ultrasound. So it wasn't a media thickness test, and it wasn't carotid. It was awful. And so Michelle and I are continuing to work on ways to get you guys access to better CIMT. As I've said, I've worked with several providers in the country. Todd's group is by far the best. He's developed national access. There are a couple of others. I still use a guy in a neurologist named Fred Callahan in Nashville, Tennessee. And there's a group in LA that occasionally does a good job. Again, we're going to be coming out to LA in September to provide you what we know is high quality CIMT. But why all the problems with the quality of CIMT? That's actually what this video is going to be about. I published a video that covered this a few months ago, but a couple of things happened. Inadvertently, that video got linked to another one, which was totally unrelated. We're looking to see if we can edit that out. It got 1,000 views, so you may have seen some of this already. If you have, and it's repeat for you, just be warned and just wait for the next video. But I think one of the problems is it made it a 30-minute video when it's really only 5 to 10 minutes. So I'm going to do a quick video for folks that haven't seen it and folks that were put off by the inappropriately long length. Anyway, so what is the purpose? What's the goal for a CIMT? It's to help patients visualize what's going on in their arteries. And again, I won't go through the details on this, but you see, going from left to right, you're getting more and more and more increase of the plaque process in your arteries. This doesn't happen in the arteries of the neck and head without happening everywhere else. So I still get patients comment to say, "Well, that's just in your neck. That's not in the heart." Your arteries are your arteries. They pump the same blood. I mean, every minute blood goes through, can make the trip throughout the whole body. So what's going on in one artery bed is going on in another. So what are the problems with? Actually, there are more than one problem with CIMT. The biggest one is technologist technique. And it has to do with what I call the problem of perspective. What does that mean? I'll get to that in just a minute. There are other issues as well. Standardization of reporting in the research has led to a bunch of really bad CIMT studies getting into the research. When you look at the groups that do it well, and again, Todd's is not the only group. His is the only one that provides national access. There's several academic groups and a couple of others that I've mentioned that do provide local access where you can get a good CIMT. And when you get a good CIMT, it's better than anything else. Because of the problems with the standardization of reporting in the literature, the standards committees looked at the literature and the science and said, "This doesn't work. It's not standardizable." Well, it is, again, in the right hands. Now let's go back and talk for a minute about this issue with the problem of perspective. Let me actually go to a picture. And you may recognize this picture if you're one of those 1,000 people that saw the original video a few months ago. This is a photographer obviously creating an optical illusion. It looks like the boys are as big as the Eiffel Tower. They're not, because they are just way, way closer to the camera. So, what does that have to do with plaque? We'll go to that in just a sec, but here's the thing to remember. Plaque is not uniform around the circumference of the artery wall. Some of it's thin, some of it's, I've got think, some of it, some of it's thick. So again, perspective matters. Now, as you begin to look at these, you can get some, again, perspective on this issue. These are cross-sections of arteries. The red part is the muscular layer, the media. The intima is this tiny thin layer here. But then everything in between is the is plaque. And as you see here, this is liquid plaque. Now, this is fairly uniform, but still, even this one, if you took a cross-section through here, if you're shining the ultrasound waves through here, you get the back end, the opposite side of the artery that you're coming in from. So if the technologist is coming through here, they're going to get this thickness. On the other hand, obviously, if they were coming through here, they're going to get a thicker amount. Now, you don't really have that much ability to mess this up, but you do have some, and it is significant. Look at this artery, for example. Huge amounts of plaque on this side. So, for example, if the wand came in through here, you'd get this much plaque. If it came in through here, you'd get a much bigger amount. And obviously, if it came in through here, you might get much less or nothing at all. And yes, you will routinely see plaques that have been missed. Again, even with the problems with CIMT, if you get a good one, a good high-quality CIMT, it tells you so much more than any other measure that we have. This is just, again, another look at a real live artery, and we'll go in and look at some others in just a second. As you see, this was soft plaque. That's no longer soft anymore. It has broken through the intima layer, and a clot has formed, this black thing. The majority of that clot broke off and went on to cause the heart attack, which killed this patient. But again, as you can see here, this is the media, this clear white looking area. That's the intima, and then so that's the plaque. So much less plaque if you had come in from that side, much more plaque if you came in from over here, and again more plaque if you came in from this perspective. Another artery which again shows a significant variation, and again the potential ways to miss plaque if you're coming in from a CIMT. So again, as you might say, look, this is awful, this is terrible. Let's get back and think about the alternatives. The most commonly used alternative is a stress test. It doesn't see anything at all unless there's over 50% occlusion, and it has up to 30% false positives over that many false negatives, because 68% of heart attacks occur in people that have less than 50% occlusion. So by definition, those people are going to have a false negative stress test. Well, you say, well, let's go to get a calcium score. As many viewers have pointed out, calcium score measures only calcium. And plaque like this that's soft, that is likely to rupture and cause a heart attack, doesn't have calcium in it. So that would not show at all on a coronary calcium score. Now, to get a little bit more perspective, here's a model of a carotid artery, obviously in a dummy, and you can begin to get a little bit more vision. And as I'm using, obviously, talking about maybe if my hand were the wand, the ultrasound wand. I've trained some in doing these. I'm not very good at doing them. But as you can see, you've got to know exactly which level to get the carotid bulb. You've got to know whether to come in from this side versus this side. And again, that is a significant variation when you begin to think about the variation that you can see in these arteries. Bottom line is, it is not easy to get a good picture of plaque. You've got moving arteries, and that's a problem with things like CTA, computed tomography, angiogram. It's also a problem with other items as well. You've got moving arteries, you've got plaque that is not uniform in terms of its coverage around the circumference of the artery. You've got the fact that arteries in the chest are behind bones, and you've got the fact that measuring blood flow, like using something like a stress test, doesn't work because you get plenty of blood flow even though you may have significant amount of plaque and plaque that can cause a heart attack and stroke. So hopefully that helps you get some more perspective on CIMT, the problems with CIMT, and how those compare to other methods of understanding and measuring screening for plaque. If you've made it this far, thank you very much for your interest.
My name is Ford Brewer. I started off my career as an ER doc, and that can be frustrating, because most of the things bringing patients into the ER can and should be prevented, like heart attack and stroke. So I went to Johns Hopkins for training in prevention, did well, ended up running the program. trained dozens of docs there, and have trained hundreds and even over 1,000 doctors since then in preventing disease. What's even more important is I've helped thousands of patients prevent heart attack and stroke rather than waiting for the devastation and hoping for a cure.